Hey, AfterBuzzers, we are so excited to talk about episode 7, No Favor Here's, on Sun Records. We have Keir O'Donnell in the studio, so stick around.
You're tuning into the destination for TV superfan discussion, AfterBuzz TV. And now, let the buzz begin.
Tamra, you're doing such a great job of singing this earlier.
16, coaches law.
Well, hey, guys.
Whoa.
Sing it, Tamra. We got a new Elvis in the building, guys.
Is that Drake over there? Oh, my God, it's Tamra. I'm sorry. I thought it was Drake for a second.
I get that a lot.
Well, hey, guys, thank you so much for joining us tonight. We have the amazing Keir O'Donnell in the studio.
Well,
how are you doing?
Amazing.
Yes.
Thank you so much for being here.
Right up for that. Thanks, guys. Thanks for having me. I do want to say right off the bat that I love this show. I told you guys out there, but I'm serious. You guys do an awesome job, and thank you for supporting our show.
Of course.
And thanks for having me.
Of course.
And thank you guys out there.
Yes. Hashtag Renew Sun Records. Make sure you are tweeting that as well. But here, can they find you on any social media platforms?
Yes. I am at Ali Nasta. No, that's you. I'm reading the wrong cue card. I'm on Twitter. It's a new one.
Heard of it?
At Keir O'Donnell. That's K E I R O'Donnell.
Sounds
two N's,
good.
Two L's. Yeah. I'm kind of new to the Twitter thing, so yeah.
I mean, you've been doing a great job, though.
Well, thanks.
Yeah.
It's been fun. You know, I mean, the show makes it easy and
awesome.
Fun.
Margaret Ann said how you guys, on the air nights, you guys are, like, tweeting at each other and talking to
each
other.
It's the best. I was doing it tonight, actually, because she was doing an interview in New York, and yeah.
Well, right before we get into it, Tamra, where can they find you on social media?
You can find me on Twitter at Brown Tamra.
Amazing. And you can find me on Twitter at Ali Nasta and on Instagram at Ali Girl. We are all just always on our cell phones tweeting away. Again, hashtag Renew Sun Records. But anyways, to get into it, Keir, do you feel like you're chiming in on your inner Dewey right now with the headphones?
I do. That's what I was saying. I was like, I'm having flashbacks here. So if I all of a sudden just go into character and, you know, forgive me.
Yeah,
if I start like reaching for the records.
Yeah,
we would not be opposed.
Keep our engineer on his toes. You can call something
yeah,
out.
Exactly.
And put it on.
Yeah.
Actually, that's what Leslie did last week.
That sounds like Leslie, where he just like takes over and he's like, "This is now my studio."
No.
Well, yeah. So if I start throwing stuff all of a sudden, I can just blame that on Dewey.
Yes, Dewey all the way. Which I'd like to say, you do such a great job of capturing this character, because obviously we see Dewey every week on the episodes, and when you see you in person, you're like, whoa, this is a different person.
Yeah.
Clearly, obviously, you're playing a character, but I feel like sometimes when you see actors, they kind of somewhat like resonate with that character, and I feel like you're two separate people. So just kudos.
Thanks.
You're doing an amazing job.
Thanks, guys.
Of course.
Thanks.
Well, how do you feel playing Dewey? How is it like being on set? What's your favorite part?
It's incredible. I mean, like you said, it's the guy could probably not be further from me personally. I tend to be like a pretty shy, sort of reserved person. So
you don't pee on classic cars.
I do that. That's the one thing that we haven't done.
Oh, okay. Cool.
Yeah, every chance I get. I just pee in public. Well, we're off to a good start. What is that? You know, when I first heard the recordings of Dewey, I had heard his name and stuff. I sort of like vaguely knew who he was, but I didn't know how prolific he was, and I certainly didn't know what he sounded like. So there is quite a lot of audio out there. So I just started studying that. You can find it on YouTube and stuff. And it's wild.
I never thought to do that.
Cool. You got to do it. It's so cool, but it's like, I mean, talk about, you know, me being fast on the show and stuff. He's like light years beyond that. And so much of it, you just can't understand. He just runs it all together. Obviously, working with our director, Roland Joffe, you know, he was like, I think we got to sort of, you know, spoon feed it a little bit more so people can understand what you're saying. So we found, you know, a ground in between. But just reading up about Dewey and just learning about that time period, but him especially. There's not a single person who doesn't say just sort of, you know, how energetic he was, how fun and just how much he loved music, you know. It's been a blast.
Do you have to what scene was it on tonight's episode where you exclaimed like a Googa Booga.
Great Googa Booga.
Yeah. Are those like scripted out, or
that is scripted. I mean, I definitely take my own liberties here and there, but the writers did an incredible job of really finding his vernacular and everything. And but yeah, I've definitely added in some like "dee gaw" and stuff, you know, which is like the more that I can get away with before they're like, let's cut that down a little bit, you know. But that great Googa Mooga was that's all them, and that one was in there tonight. Yeah, that's when like I go into Lansky's and Elvis turns around and is like gold.
Oh, that's right.
And I got to do the like the
our backdrop looks like an Elvis suit. It
does. Yeah, it does. So I'll give you one live. Great Googa Mooga. Yeah.
Love that, folks. Yes, I was. I actually had wrote down that exact line, and I said your lines are just over the top. So it's got to be so much fun because each one is just like a standalone, crazy, outlandish thing.
It's the best. I mean, you know, every time I got a script, it was like, are you kidding? I get to say that, and it's sort of like, how am I going to say it? I mean, my favorite one tonight was when I'm watching Elvis from the side of the stage at the Overton Park Shell, and you know, and I walk up, and all the girls are going crazy, and I go. And then Bobby Sox gals are clawing at him like a naked Marlon Brando covered in ice cream sundaes. It's like, are you kidding? You know, you read that
and
you go like.
It's so cat on a hot tin roof.
Right? Exactly. Yeah. It's just like, you know, it's like Shakespeare. It just like rolls off the tongue. So
Shakespeare,
yeah.
Weren't you Romeo in something, actually?
Whoa, someone's been doing
research.
Deep.
My God, that's some deep research right there. Well, there's something that I know about you from high school.
Ooh.
Come on out. We brought. No, I don't know.
Yeah, I know. I know what it is. Yeah. It's like bringing the dancing lobsters.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. It's the girl who bullied you. Come on in. I played Romeo in college my senior year. Yeah, this conservatory that I studied acting at
so
in Hartford,
did Shakespeare play into a little bit of this do role then, you say, in all the reciting of the lines?
It
and does,
for sure. I mean, you know, we of course study text and you know, and also physicality. I like bringing a lot of physicality to roles.
Iambic
and,
pentameter.
There you go, exactly. That's I've broken down Dewey's text in order for it to... Nah. But it does. It helps you, you know, like studying classical theater, which is what I did for 4 years. It helps you sort of analyze text and, you know, really make the role whole, you know,
definitely.
Like from the physicality to everything else. So,
which the physicality you definitely do, and like just the posture and everything. Mm-hmm. I don't know why I feel like this episode I just noticed it so much more. He's just always, I don't know, just the way he's like always pulling out the flask and just over the top.
Yeah.
It's just you're never
very
stopping.
Wiggly.
Yeah,
he's very,
very
wiggly.
He's wiggly, but you know, it was a prop nightmare. I remember when I first talked to Leslie, you know, who was here last week, of course, our executive producer, and he. You know, when I first got on set and he was like looking at my wardrobe and stuff, I had all these pockets and he's like, I want cigarettes in every pocket. He's like, you're always smoking. I'm like, okay. And then you get into the you know, into Dewey's booth, which they rebuilt and is incredible. But everything works in there. You know, all the record players and everything, all the switches. So I had the real guy from Sun Records come down and teach me how to use the whole booth. But you know, it's like I'm doing this like literally what they call hillbilly rap, you know, where I'm just like speeding through this, like, yes, sir, good people, and you're like, oh my God, like this, and the cigarettes, and the thing, and the bells and whistle. I mean, it was a lot. It was like really juggling, you know, both sides of your brain.
That's a skill DJs don't have to have anymore.
Yeah, exactly,
just to, like,
right?
Just keep talking. We do, but DJs don't, on the radio don't.
You guys just have to drink water and talk into the mic. Let me tell you something.
And talk to great people, just like yourself.
Exactly. Easy.
No. But yeah, I mean, what, like, do you have any like pre-ritual things right before you go on to perform? Because clearly you have so many things going on in your mind, whether it's the crazy lines, the over like craziness of your, I don't know, what am I doing? Your gestures, your hand gestures, everything. Like, do you have anything you do before?
I do. I mean, I guess it's different for every character.
Yeah.
I've tried weird stuff in the past too, because I like to create characters sort of from the outside in, meaning, you know, like wardrobe, the physicality, and just their mannerisms and everything. And then this sort of like the inside turmoil sort of, you know, comes out of that.
Definitely.
So I guess with Dewey, it was just really finding his kind of, the way that he moved, the way that he talked. I always noticed in pictures that his kind of lip is to the side a lot. I don't know if that was from like too much prescription medication. but regardless, you know, like once I kind of started doing that, it was like, oh man, this is the accent. He kind of gets going, and you know, so it sort of started with that. So there's little weird things that I can, jump into that, it just sort of slides right in.
Oh, great. Well, speaking of things that happened this episode too, you guys were on set when you were when Elvis was actually performing. You were mentioning that this was all live and happening while you guys were there. It wasn't.
Yeah.
It wasn't filmed in segments. You were hearing Elvis or Drake live.
That's right. And also the Overton Park Shell, the whole, you know, the first Elvis's first appearance tonight, we actually shot that at Overton Park Shell, which was so cool. And it was incredible. I mean, that was a rare circumstance where Drake was singing to a track, but it was him singing, right?
Yeah,
he had
yeah.
recorded the track just because we had to do so many angles
of
and
course.
Stuff like that. He couldn't sing it live every time. You know, but for the most part, every other time you hear him sing, it is live on the show. But it's still, I mean, it's incredible. Yeah, you see him like wiggling around and the girls just going crazy and you're watching it from backstage at
yeah.
the actual place where it happened. You just... You know,
yeah.
you get goosebumps. It's incredible.
I know the shot where you're introducing him, and when it's Drake, but the camera's going around him.
Yeah. Well, they did it for both of us, right? Yeah. So they elevated us. They put us on these like crates. I don't know if it's because I'm too short or something. Come to think of it. No, but they put us up on crates so that the camera guy could just like walk around us.
Yeah,
it was wild.
That was a cool shot.
Very cool. And to kind of get the lights, the flares behind us and everything. Yeah, very cool. Very cool.
They do such a good job of
right?
What do you call that? The cinematography?
There you go.
Yeah, I mean, we've talked about this every episode so far, and it's just like the cinematography of everything and how it's beautifully shot, and you just feel like you're there.
Yeah.
After Elvis's performance today, I almost wanted to get up and start clapping.
And
then I was like, okay, I can't do that. I'm actually
Allie
watching.
Allie was taking off her top while we were watching.
Yeah, I was like, this is getting awkward. In all fairness, I was doing the same thing. I was like, go, Elvis. So we were all in it together.
I was like Mr. Presley. I was sitting there with my arms crossed.
Yeah, you were like,
never
young man, get off the stage. I heard you say at one point. I don't know.
Should go back to the factory. I've got no future here, boy.
Guys,
I feel like this is like an audition. Are you using this as an audition tape to get on the show? Because let me tell you, you are cast.
No.
You're in.
Leslie, if Drake's busy next season...
Tamra's
curse. Elvis? No, I was talking about Dewey Phillips. We haven't met Dewey Phillips' wife yet.
Oh, I see.
Oh.
Man, you guys.
I thought Dewey was gay.
Good, I'm glad that's coming off. I'm glad that's coming through with my performance.
You guys, so lost right now.
Very subtle, yeah.
Laughing so
we'll
hard.
Cut all this out later. Don't worry. It's live.
Yeah.
I'm hearing that this is live.
This
and
is
I
live.
Apologize.
And I'm like crying of laughter right now.
By the way, that line was really funny of when Trixie is on the steps talking to Elvis, and she's like, she says something about how she has Tony Curtis is so cute with
yeah,
that
right.
black hair.
Yeah. And then he dyes his hair later.
Tony Curtis is notoriously gay. That was a funny line.
Right, of course. Oh, that's amazing. I didn't even think about that. That's,
I know. Tamra can always pick out the things that
I have.
She's like so in tune with
I told you, I've watched every show that you guys have done. I'm like terrified to like... He's sitting beside the encyclopedia.
I don't know. I say a lot of wrong things, though, too. I'll be like...
right.
Yeah.
Don't we all? I'm just so, like... I was so scared to, like, come in here and, like, of course... They're like, scoot closer to... And I'm like, I just don't want, you know, you to be like... It's pronounced Dewey Phillips. I'm like, oh, God.
6 inches.
No.
6 inches,
Kier.
You
hit me if I say something
6 inches
like
from
that.
The mic or... from Tamra.
Yeah. Promise we don't bite. We're very nice. No, but you know, Elvis, I feel like we saw a lot more of him and we're seeing a lot more of every character in the show, especially this episode, and everything's picking up. And we were talking about how it goes so quickly, and
yeah.
I feel like this episode in general, everybody was in love. I had a case of the smiles. I was so excited. And then everybody was in all of a sudden cheating on each other.
Right.
Was a little crazy. And you were talking about how, you know, Marianne, like, people are feeling for her, but at the same time, it's like, it's a double-edged sword, because you feel for Marianne, you feel for Becky, because there's this love triangle going on.
Yeah, I know, you know, so many people are sort of, like, rooting for, like, Marianne and Sam, but, like, you have to remember that, you know, Becky's like pregnant this whole time. Yeah. That is his wife. You know, I mean, it's a little bit dicey. It's a little tricky. But of course, you know, that is the sort of love triangle within the show. And now Earl comes along for Marion. And
right.
So, you know, it's playing those dynamics. But I know, like, God, there was a lot of like, it was a steamy episode.
It was a steamy episode.
Steamy episode. And a lot of cheating going on. A lot of. Yeah, Jerry Lee, man, the killer is starting to come out.
He
you
is.
See him, man.
Oh my
the
gosh,
bad boy.
Jerry and Jimmy, this episode too. Every time we get more and
just
more
the
of
best,
them,
yeah.
I get so excited.
The best.
And like, even if they're doing something bad, it's so fun to watch.
Yeah.
And Peggy as well, Kate Poole, who
amazing.
Plays her, she did
beautiful,
phenomenal
yeah.
this episode.
Incredible.
And I just think it's fun to get more bits and pieces of each of the storyline as we've come along so far.
And in their storyline, I think we're seeing like. Because Jimmy's getting more and more jealous, it seems. And so in that scene where Peggy catches Jerry Lee, it seems like Jimmy tipped her off, right?
Totally,
isn't that,
right?
Isn't that what happened?
Totally. And
right.
he sort of blocks the way
yeah.
for Jerry, you know, this, yeah.
Yeah, so. I mean, I'm thinking, I mean, I haven't, I need to, like, do my history. People are probably going to correct me, but I mean, do they end up together? Because I don't know, so we'll have to find out.
But, you'll just have to wait for episode 9 in yeah. 2 weeks. No, episode 8 is the last one.
Yeah, no, I'm super excited for that. But, I mean, we finally also got the amazing shot, which they do all the Sun Records stuff, which is when they're facing the cameras with all the lights behind Elvis, and he's, like, got that, like, I don't know, did you guys notice that?
When
he's, like, making
yeah.
that pose and like that's what all the Sun Records posters are. We finally got
yeah.
that shot. And it was
yeah.
like, this
oh,
is exciting.
Oh, cool.
Yeah.
Yeah, sorry, that was something I was like, that was fun to see because we finally got the amazing shot from the show.
Oh, gotcha.
But,
yeah.
Well, that's when I looked cool. over at you when you were watching it and you had like tears in your eyes. You were like, this is the moment. That's
this
it's all making
so
sense
great.
Now.
But yeah, I mean, also too, with like the performances and everything, do you have like a favorite storyline that you've been following watching outside, not just filming?
I mean, outside of my storyline,
yes,
is
outside.
What you're saying?
Sorry.
Well, no, I guess that's pretty bold of me to say. Outside of my storyline, which is the greatest storyline.
Which Dewey's is amazing.
No, I mean, the boy, like, the twins are just incredible, mm-hmm. you know? Like, Jerry Lee and Jimmy are just so fun to watch
yeah,
and that sort of
definitely.
Dynamic. But everybody, that's what I love about the show is that when we first get these scripts, it's a large cast. And it interweaves all these stories, and you go, God, I wonder if it's going to work, if we're spending too much time on one person or this
right.
and that, how it's going to sort of cut together. And so much of filming was we would shoot so much, and then you'd have so much time off because you're not in so much. So it feels like disjointed somehow, and then to see it all come together. And they just did like a masterful job weaving it all together. So I don't know. That being said, it's like everybody's storyline, I think, is riveting and sort of really interesting how it all sort of weaves together and how it's starting to cross now. Of course, Colonel meets Elvis and starts
yes.
to put in his talons. So, yeah.
Yeah, and I think it's super exciting as an audience member to see things start to pan out. And obviously, I've mentioned this before, I don't know all of the history that's gone on. So it's super fun. It's like kind of a thriller for me because I'm not sure exactly how it's going to pan out.
Yeah.
And it's almost like I'm like saving myself. I'm not actually doing all the research to find out what happens later.
Right.
So it is.
Well, it's a good thing. Dewey starts just killing people. So it turns into a real thriller.
With records. He uses them to sever heads.
You didn't hear about that in history, did you? Don't Google it. Do not Google it. There's some gnarly stuff.
There's a dark side to Sun Records.
Yeah.
Yeah. Well, you know, playing Dewey, like, obviously he's a huge fan of music. He really
yeah.
is passionate about all the things that he's playing on the radio. Do you have any passionate things about music, certain genres you like to listen
big
to?
Big time. Yeah, I have always been a really, really big music guy. I love live music, especially. I go to a lot of concerts. I always tend to just buy far too many tickets for stuff. You know, just in the future, I'm just, like, buying, and
yeah.
then, you know, I can't go to half of it. But, yeah, I do.
That's a lot of Ticketmaster surcharges.
Yeah, oh, no, I just scalp them on Craigslist
oh,
and make
perfect.
A ton of money. This is not live. Tell me this is not live. I love music. So that was obviously a great connection that I had
right.
with Dewey that's very easy for me to connect to. I mean, one of the moments in, I think, like two episodes ago, whatever, when Dewey has this face cut, you know, and Earl
yeah.
comes in and goes, man, you know, it's not worth it. It's just music. And Dewey goes like, just music, man. Music is in my blood, you know? And that's something I that was very easy for me to get to that place, you know, because I feel that way.
That's great. Certainly.
That scene particularly, I was like, oh!
Yeah, yeah. I think a lot of people were.
What have you seen recently? Live concert.
Oh, man. God, I've been working so much that I haven't seen a ton recently. Although I just bought tickets for Explosions in the Sky. You're going to be at the Greek Theater. Do you know them?
Mm-mm.
It's like an instrumental band.
Okay.
From Austin. They're going to be at the Greek Theater in September, I think. A friend of mine is playing the Troubadour next Friday, Joe
Ooh.
Purdy.
Oh,
nice. Shout out to Joe.
Yeah, shout out to Joe. Yeah, lots of good stuff coming up.
Cool.
Timber, there's a band I like, playing at the Echo.
Okay,
I should maybe I shouldn't tell people. Like, I'm going to all these shows. I will see you there.
Where you can find Keir.
Yeah.
Well, that, like, would you have any fans of, like, were you fans of Elvis or Johnny or any of Jerry Lee Lewis, any of these?
Who?
Yeah. Come again? Never heard of them. They just came out now, or?
Were you fans of them?
Millennials, am I right?
Emo band?
Were you fans of any of them before the show started?
Yes, yeah, absolutely. I mean, I you know, truth be told, I wasn't like a massive fan of these
right.
guys. Of course, I knew all of them and their music very well. But like, I don't know if I was always like into like darker, moody,
like emo
yeah, I still
music,
am
right?
like emo stuff. Yeah, like more like emo stuff. No, I am into like really sad like. You know, sort of kill yourself music.
A lot of Robert Smith.
You know, yeah. I'll get down with that. Or at least some Bon Iver, and you know, like anything in that sort of wheelhouse of like, just sad kind of. Wow, I really just brought the mood down, didn't I? I really brought it down. I could feel it, like just like.
If we can put on some like, Belle and Sebastian
actually,
for a moment.
Actually, I did have a game for you.
No, I'm not in the mood anymore. Can we put on some sad music?
So now I understand. Everybody that we've talked to so far has said that you're one of the funniest people in the cast.
Yeah. Lies.
I totally understand now.
All lies.
I'm like crying from laughing so hard. But okay, so we actually, I had a little quiz I wanted to play for you.
Whoa.
Where since you play a DJ in the show.
Oh, boy.
I don't know what she's about to do here.
I wanted to play some music and you have to name the artist and the song.
Oh my God.
Can we pull that? Do you have that pulled up?
Oh, well, I can just read it when he's pulling it up. No, I'll look away.
I sent it in the and it should be in the email.
Oh,
but
God.
If we don't have that, we can just play some random music.
It's like new stuff or old stuff or
no, it's old stuff. I made
God,
a pretty
you're
easy choice.
Kill me here. Oh no,
so,
you're gonna kill this.
I don't think so. I can't.
You just like whisper them to
I
me.
Can't
I think you're gonna be. I think you're gonna be
enough.
Great. You're gonna be great. With this, but in the meantime, while we're pulling that up,
no, why don't you just sing the songs and we'll guess.
Here's a quiz.
Like, oh my gosh,
who's your favorite DJ of all time?
My favorite would be Dewey Phillips.
Thank you.
Obviously.
Thank you.
Yeah. No.
I had to like kick her under the table with that one.
Yeah. I'm excited to look up Dewey Phillips on YouTube. I never thought to do that.
It's awesome. I mean, there's only one video of him that I can find. But he actually had a TV show for a little bit.
Oh, really?
Yeah, and there's a video on YouTube of him and Jerry Lee Lewis.
Oh, okay.
Really?
Yeah, and it's a short clip, but mainly his audio clips on YouTube.
Yeah, so that was the show, like, you could actually see his mannerisms and things? And was
yeah,
that...
I mean, it's such a small thing, and I feel like everything I read as well, there's
He's
this great...
He's not still alive, right?
Dewey? Mm-hmm. No, he died when he was 42.
Oh, wow.
I know, same age as Elvis.
Because of all the cigarettes
died
in every 42. Pocket?
Yeah, exactly. Oh, well, and the booze and the pills
sure.
and God knows what else.
That too.
But yeah, he died at 42. Elvis died at 42 as well, which I made a massive error earlier today in an interview saying... Dewey died in 1968, and Elvis died in what I said was 10 years later, exactly, meaning they were both 42, but I said Elvis died in 1978, and he didn't. I know. I get it. I correct my mistake. He died in 1977.
Is that off your chest? We're good.
That is. It's like, you know, you can't mess stuff up about
when
Elvis.
When in That's 77? It. Because... This would be the 40th anniversary of his death this year. Has it happened yet?
Oh, yeah.
Or is it coming?
Because
that's going to be a big deal.
God, I need to stop, like, you know, opening my mouth and getting Elvis fans, like, jumping on my back. I don't
All right,
know. So, it was technically April 2nd, 1977. No. I don't know.
All right. Well, we're going to play these songs, and you have to name the name of the song and then the artist.
Jeez.
And we're going to give you like 15,
oh, guys.
15 seconds.
Help me out here.
All right. Okay. So we're going to play number one.
Great. Great.
Are you lonesome tonight?
Okay. That's it. That's all I got. I think I have it.
Okay.
Are You Lonesome Tonight by One Direction? Is it?
Yes!
It is, right? It
yeah!
is. Thank you. Thanks. I could tell. I know Harry Styles' voice anywhere.
Anywhere.
I tell you, I didn't just get this job just from not doing research.
Well, Dewey Phillips, just to confirm, it's Elvis Presley.
Yes.
Yes.
It's actually pronounced Alvin Presney, but
great
nice
job.
Try.
So close. Great job. All
so
right.
Close.
So number two. This one should be an easy one.
Oh,
we'll
gosh.
See how this goes.
Okay. You shake my nerves and you rattle my brain. Yeah. Yeah.
You don't know this one, do you? You broke my will. It's tough. All right. I'm loving these
That was from the original film Great Balls. No,
this is the Hamilton soundtrack, wasn't it?
Yes, exactly. Great Balls of Fire, of course, by Christian Lee's.
Yeah.
Jerry Lee Lewis.
They're one and the same.
I get them confused all the time.
Yeah, of course.
Well, we said that at the same sentence, I was going to say. Time. God.
Okay. Epic. We're going to do number three. Mm-hmm. You are 2-for-2 right now.
Wow.
Let's go on number three.
Time to go downhill. Yeah. Feeling pretty good about this one.
Meow, 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 meow. All right.
Well, here, dude, boom.
Oh, that was really great.
That was, I run the line. No, I jog the line. It's close.
Colder.
I strut the line.
Right there.
Ah, God, I just can't walk my way to it. God, I'm dragging this out. I walk the line.
Bye. Amazing.
By Joaquin Phoenix.
Thank you. You saved me there. But so, Johnny Cash.
So embarrassing.
I'm Johnny Cash. God, that's bad.
All right. And last but not least, we've got number four. This is the last one.
Oh, man.
Secret Agent Man.
Well, how come you say you will when you won't? You tell me you do, baby, when you don't. Let me know, honey, how you feel. It does. Sounds like Secret Agent Man.
Honey, don't.
Yay! You are the winner. You have won all four.
Well, this was a failure. See, go. Oh, just saw your curtains again. I'm back. We're back from commercial break. I'm your host, Ali Nass.
On the ones and twos.
On the ones and twos.
All right. Well, you are a 4-for-4, so I think definitely Dewey Phillips.
Wait, who sang the last one?
No, I was 4. No, I'm 4-for-4. I think 4-for-4.
Carl Perkins.
4-for-4.
Which we get introduced to Carl Perkins next.
That's
episode,
right.
Dewey.
Dustin Ingram, who kills it, and it's I know. Finally, the fans have been asking, where is Carl? He's coming.
Yeah.
He's coming.
I've actually heard a lot of people be like, where is Carl Perkins? What's happening? You've even mentioned that a couple times.
Yes,
where
I have.
Is Carl Perkins is what everyone's been saying. No, but it's true. I mean, he is such a prolific artist, obviously, and writer, you know, and influenced all of these guys and many future artists to come. So, yeah, he's and Dustin's an amazing actor and really embodies him. So, yeah. Cool.
Yeah, super, super exciting. I mean, it's just so crazy. It blows my mind every episode about to see how fluid everybody is and how integral they are. Like, they mirror these real life people so well. And even though I didn't grow up like seeing them alive, but there were, you know, after videos and things that you're able to see them depict these characters, it's amazing. You guys all do such a phenomenal job.
Well,
so
thanks.
I'm sure Carl Perkins will be just as good.
Yeah.
I mean, just kind of getting into the other side of things and being on the other side of the camera, what was your favorite part about being on set and just kind of filming this whole show?
Man, I mean, actually shooting in Memphis was a huge thing. I know everyone's talked about that, but that is, I mean, just to be in the places that these actual guys stood and lived is pretty... It's wild. I mean, you really don't understand the significance of it until you're in that space. I mean, I got to go, we all got to go, obviously, to Sun Studios. And when you take the tour, they actually have Dewey Phillips' booth set up there in like a sort of glass, like encapsulation. And, on the floor, like broken records and stuff, because he did. He like tossed records a lot.
it sounds like a euphemism for like...
Yeah,
I lost my cookies. Yeah. I tossed my records.
Yeah, exactly. Dewey tossed a lot of records. So the set designers, they rebuilt that exact thing. But to see it and to feel that, and then to be sitting down at that, it's just you really get transported to a different time and place.
Definitely. Yeah. And you had mentioned earlier that you actually had someone from Sun Records come in, like show you how the
that's
board
right.
and everything.
Yeah,
worked.
That's right. They all. Sorry.
My that's hair okay. Is,
I'm melting. I'm melting. Hair, makeup, let's take a commercial break.
We'll be right back.
They had the real guys at who work at Sun Records, and they still record artists there, which is really cool. And they let us come down and see some artists being recorded. But they came to set a bunch and taught us just how to use all the equipment. So it was really cool.
That's amazing.
Made it that much more authentic.
What's the music of that they're recording now?
New artists. I mean, Jack White recorded in there.
Yeah,
and, a bunch of... They literally, rent it out still. So, as a recording artist, you can go and, pay money. And, it's no longer, whatever it was, $1.35 or whatever it was, But... I think they invite some artists. I mean, I think U2, recorded one of their earlier albums there.
Oh, okay.
Yeah.
That's crazy. I actually... Weirdly enough, my dad used to be in a band, and the band he was in, he had mentioned a couple months ago, they went back and recorded there.
Really?
Yeah, I was like,
wow.
Yeah. I guess
that's so cool.
So I think, I don't know the what happened, but he had just mentioned that to me, and I was like, what?
Yeah, it's pretty wild. A friend of mine just recorded there, Elle King, and she said it was just incredible. I mean, of course, especially for a recording artist,
yeah.
I mean, to stand literally, they have that X on the floor where Elvis stood, and it's pretty cool. You guys have never been there? I can't believe you've never been there. That's insane.
I know. In fact, this shirt that I'm wearing, it's the Bow Keys. This is a Memphis band that's comprised of all of the remaining Stax Records guys that are still alive.
Yeah, no, I know.
No,
I'm just kidding.
I didn't even
I know everything about music. Yes, of course, I knew that. The Bow Keys.
Sun Records and Stax Records so much that I...
And Stax is awesome, too. I mean, to go through that, you would love it. You got to go.
Yeah,
you got to go. It's
know.
Awesome. And Graceland, of course,
Oh, my. And you guys, did you guys do a tour of
we
that?
Did, of Graceland. Yeah, all together. We went to Sun, many, many times. But,
yeah.
But, yeah, we went as a big group to Graceland. They gave us sort of, little private tour of the thing. I mean, it's crazy.
Yeah,
I'm
sure
incredible.
That was, the best time, too. And just knowing that you're playing these characters and you're walking through some of the places that they... I mean, I couldn't, could you have imagined filming it in any other place than Memphis?
No, not at all. I mean, it's, it's also, there's so much that's preserved about Memphis that there was a lot of stuff that we didn't even need, art decoration for. You could just walk down these streets, and it hasn't changed since the 50s. It's just, really incredible. And all these restaurants and stuff that they were like, Dewey used to eat in that restaurant is still that restaurant. You know what I mean? It's not like a chain now or something.
Yeah.
It's like,
it's
of
not
course,
a Buffalo
it's
Wild Wings.
Right,
now.
Exactly. Yeah. I mean, I'm sure it's gone through different incarnations and stuff, but it's still the same name. All this stuff. The Green Beetle was down the road from where we were all living, which was the Chiska Hotel, which is where Dewey Phillips had his radio show out of. Is
what?
Where we were living. I was
cool.
Living at the top floor. And that was the actual building that they just had renovated and just opened up as apartments.
Oh, wow.
That's
crazy.
So
it was
were in this hotel the whole time?
All of us. They're live-in apartments.
It was like a dorm.
How cool
fun.
Is that, right?
Yeah.
And it's you could just feel Dewey, in the hallways.
That's super
pretty rad.
Fun.
Yeah, it was cool.
That's so great. From what we've heard so far, it sounds like the most fun. We're always they were talking about how it was summer camp and
of
you guys
course,
band
I know.
Camp.
I mean, I know it sounds so cheesy or whatever, but the cast really, they're so exceptional. But we all got along so well, which is definitely a rare experience. You know, I've seen it come and go here before, but
Who did you like the least?
The least. It's so funny how, like, often people actually do ask that question.
Wait, really?
Who did you like the most, and who did you like the least? It's like,
fight with.
Yeah. But I actually can't answer that. No.
Who's the biggest asshole?
Yeah, exactly, right. Well, but you know what else is crazy is that we vary in ages so much. I mean, like, those guys are really young. I mean, for me, I'm like 30. But, you know, those guys are, like, in their late teens. I mean, Drake was 17 when we were shooting, just turned 18.
Oh, wow.
You know, the Lees brothers were 20, just turned 21. They couldn't even get into bars and stuff, you know?
Oh, my gosh.
And it's, it's as if, I mean, I felt like, you know, I was their sort of, like, older brother in a lot of ways.
Yeah. Oh.
Mentor, if you will, you know?
Yeah.
God, savior, whatever, you know, these are the terms they use, not me. But you know, but they all looked up to me, and but I love those guys. I love all those guys, and you know, it's just a family. It's a family.
Yeah, of course, and we're all seriously hoping for a season 2. I mean, we've heard things from Leslie and everything, and it's just like, if we can get that, crossing our fingers, hashtagging Renew Sun Records.
It's up to you guys out there to keep on
hashtagging.
That's
sharing,
right. If it doesn't happen, it is all your fault. It's
there.
All your fault if you don't do
you
it.
You are responsible for the future of television.
And my career, for God's sake. Daddy needs a paycheck.
Do you want that on you? Do you want that on your shoulders?
Do you want that on your conscience?
Great Googamooga.
I'm coming for you. Great Googamooga.
Oh, my gosh. Well, seriously, right before we wrap this up, you have some things happening for you recently, like as in tomorrow.
Yeah.
He's got to go to the grocery store.
I do, yeah.
No, you have a new project coming out. It's
I do, yeah. I'm filming this Showtime show called Ray Donovan that's in its fifth season. So yeah, I'm jumping back into that tomorrow. I'm doing a bunch of episodes on this new season that'll probably start airing like in the summer sometime. But yeah, they just announced that Susan Sarandon is going to be playing my mom, which is super cool.
Yeah.
So I get to meet her tomorrow, and I'm not nervous at all. So that's good. But yeah, I was also just on this FX show called Legion. It's by Noah Hawley, the same guy who did Fargo that I was on that second season. And I have a movie coming out tomorrow.
Yeah.
God, again, I just killed the mood. They were like, can this guy stop talking about his career and his project?
Yeah, you said it like, but you're going to have to figure out
what it is. Oh, I thought you were saying, you seemed so disappointed. I was like, oh, yeah, I'm working tomorrow. You're like, that's not the thing I was talking about.
We were waiting for that so we can see you on the big screen.
Yes, I have a movie coming out tomorrow. It's in selected theaters tomorrow, but it's a wide release in theaters everywhere next week. It's called Gifted. With Chris Evans, Captain America, and Octavia Spencer, Academy Award winner.
Ooh, amazing.
Jenny Slate. Yeah, and it's directed by Mark Webb, the guy who did 500 Days of Summer and the last Spider-Man movies.
Awesome.
So it's really cool. It's really heartfelt.
Yes.
Yeah, so I have a tiny role, but it's very pivotal, and I'm proud to be a part of it.
Amazing. Well, again, thank you so much for joining us tonight. We've had so much fun, so many laughs.
I am not leaving.
You heard it here.
This is not over.
He will be here next week when we recap the season finale, which I can't even believe we're going to be talking about the last episode of the season.
So
I can't believe it. 8 episodes just isn't enough. We need way, way more. But I guess...
Because there's a few more cast members that we haven't had in yet.
Yeah.
So we need at least a few more episodes for...
Yeah. We're talking to you. Who haven't you had?
Milk delivery man number 2.
Milk, yeah, exactly.
Yeah. Well, thank you guys again so much for joining us. We had so much fun, as always. And Keir, such a pleasure having
you. Thank you,
guys. We so appreciate it. Where, again, can they find you on social media?
I'm on Twitter at Keir O'Donnell.
Perfect.
Forgot my name for a second.
And Tamra Brown, where can they find you?
On Twitter at Brown Tamra.
And don't forget to follow AfterBuzz TV on YouTube, on Twitter, on Instagram,
where can
on
they find
Snapchat.
You
can find me on Twitter at Ali Nasta and on Instagram at Ali Girl. Thank you guys so much. We'll see you next week.
Thanks, guys.
From executive producers Maria Menounos, Kevin Undergaro, Phil Svitek, and the entire AfterBuzz TV staff, we would like to thank you for listening to the AfterBuzz TV Network. To watch or listen to other After shows and post comments or questions, be sure to visit AfterBuzzTV.com. I'm Sir Richard Wentworth, and this has been a presentation of AfterBuzz TV.
Buzz you later.
The views expressed herein are those of the hosts only and do not necessarily reflect the views of AfterBuzz TV or its owners or principals.